Now take your Bible and turn this morning to the fifth chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. I read about a man who wrote his pastor a letter, and the man said to his pastor, "I thought you might be able to help me with my dilemma. I have by all standards achieved success in my life, the success that most people work for all of their life." He said, "I have multiple homes, nice cars, a beautiful family, all types of perks and luxuries. I'm young and I'm in good health." But he then said, "I'm not happy." And he said, "To be honest, I'm restless. I'm bored. I'm often very unsatisfied with my life." He said, "Sometimes I feel hollow and empty inside, and I keep thinking there must be more to life than this." And then he asked the question, "What do you think I should do?" How would you answer that young man who wrote his pastor? "What do you think I should do?" When I read that letter, my mind immediately went to Scripture and the story of Solomon, and how Solomon tried to find everything the world had to offer to make him happy, and yet nothing did. He tried all of these same things this young man tried, and yet Solomon concluded at the end of his journey, his search for happiness, that the best education and the best houses and fortune, success, sexual thrills, becoming famous, being popular, in the end, it all means nothing. In the end, he said, it's all vanity. It's all in vain. It leaves an emptiness inside. It leaves a deep hunger in the human soul. And that's the way Solomon was until he realized the same thing that this young man must realize. And that is, this emptiness in his heart is a spiritual hunger. It's a hunger that only God can feel. And the truth is, most people today are searching for happiness. And if they were to be honest with you, they would tell you that there's this same emptiness inside, this same hollow feeling inside, this same void in their soul, and they don't know what it is. And so they go out and they try all kinds of different things, thinking those things will make them happy. But at the end of the day, they're empty. And it is because that emptiness is a spiritual emptiness. It's something that only God can feel and take care of. And that's what Jesus is talking about in the beatitude that we're going to look at today in verse 6 of Matthew 5. We're learning to live like Jesus. And in this particular verse, Jesus talks to us about a new kind of righteousness. So let's stand together with our Bibles open and look at what Jesus had to say here in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Blessed, and we've learned that the word blessed means happy. Blessed or happy are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Read the rest of it with me. For they shall be filled. Now let's read it again. Look at it again. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you for being our Savior. We ask you, Jesus, to speak to our hearts from your word through your Holy Spirit today, and help us to understand this emptiness in our life that we so often may feel is a spiritual thing. And may people today who deal with that emptiness in life find the joy and happiness that comes from you, Lord Jesus. And may their life be forever changed this day. In the name of Christ we pray, and all the church said, amen. Thank you. Be seated with your Bible open before you and a pen or pencil in your hand. And I want you to see three things today as we think about what Jesus is teaching us here about a new kind of righteousness. And the first thing is an explanation of righteousness. That word, circle the word righteousness there in verse 6. That word is found literally hundreds of times in the Bible, but this particular word is translated from a word that means the quality of being right or being just. It describes a person who is wholly conformed, entirely conformed to the will of God. Now, I want you to think about that. And the interesting thing here is in the original text that this was written, and we all know that the Bible is translated out of the Greek language, and in the Greek language of Scripture, it says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for the righteousness. For the righteousness. In other words, this is not just any kind of righteousness. This is the righteousness. This is a new righteousness. What is the righteousness? Jesus is not speaking here about just any righteousness. He's speaking about the true righteousness, the righteousness that comes only from God. Now, I want you to notice this. It's important. We are not to hunger and thirst after anything other than the righteousness of God, the true righteousness of God. You see, when we put happiness as the one thing that we desire above everything else, we will never be happy. Because happiness and searching for happiness cannot take the place of the righteousness of God. And that's what Jesus is teaching us here. He's telling us that true happiness is found only by hungering and thirsting for the righteousness of God. One great obstacle to the Jews receiving the gospel was self-righteousness. They were self-righteous. A lot of people today are self-righteous, and they think because of their self-righteousness that they're going to heaven. Not so. It's not so. And if we're not careful, we can get the attitude that because we go to church, we're better than people who don't go to church. That's self-righteousness. And that's not true. Let me say this, and I hope you'll write it down and think about it. Self-righteousness is a good indication of unrighteousness. Now, we'll say it again. Somebody say amen this time. Self-righteousness is a good indication of unrighteousness. You did good. But think about what that means. Is there any hint of self-righteousness in your heart this morning? So what is the righteousness that Jesus talks about in the Beatitudes? Well, first, this righteousness, this new way of living, the way Jesus lived, this righteousness is a relationship. It's a relationship. Righteousness, in its purest form, means being right with God. So let me ask you this morning, are you right with God in every area of your life? As you stand before God and let the Holy Spirit take an x-ray of your life, can you say in all honesty and sincerity this morning that you are wholly conformed to the will of God, that you are right with God? Righteousness is being right with God. And the only way that we can be right with God is through faith in Jesus Christ. It's the righteousness. Jesus said, I am the way. The is emphatic. He means I am the only way. Now, I know in today's world, people don't like to hear that. But the truth is the truth, whether people like to hear it or not. And Jesus said he is the only way to heaven. Can you say amen? He is the only way. He is the way of righteousness. Now, the Bible says in Romans 3:10, there is none righteous, no, not one. That means none of us are righteous in our own merit. All of us are sinners in our own right, and we all know that we have sinned. Romans 3:23 says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That means none of us, no human being, has ever measured up to the standard of God. Only Jesus did that. Only Jesus. And so all of us fall short of God's standard. All of us sin. And this sin separates us from God and it keeps us from heaven. So what do? When we turn away from our sin and we turn by faith to the Lord Jesus Christ, then God takes the righteousness of Jesus Christ and he imputes that to us. And that just means he takes the righteousness of Christ and he puts that on me, a sinner. He forgives my sin. He washes my sin. He gives me eternal life in heaven with the Lord Jesus forever when I die. I am not righteous. Jesus is righteous because God is God. He takes the righteousness of his Son and puts it on me so that I can be righteous. And when I die, I get to go to heaven. You can't beat that. Amen? I mean, that's good news. That's the gospel. That's the gospel. So righteousness is a relationship, and God has made it possible through Jesus Christ. Righteousness is also a way of life. It's a way of life. It means being right with God. Now, why should we care about being right with God? Well, number one, Jesus said here, it's the only way you can live that'll make you truly happy. That's what he's saying. He's saying happy are those who hunger and thirst for God. The only way to be truly happy is to let righteousness be a way of life. Proverbs 12:28 says, in the way of righteousness is life, and in its pathway there is no death. Now here's the point. God's not going to force us to go to heaven. God loves us, and he wants us to go to heaven. When we choose Jesus, we choose eternal life. When we reject Jesus, we choose separation forever from God in hell. And that is a choice that every human being must make. This week I heard about a person who lost their appetite and they had lost a lot of weight and in a very short period of time. And they went to the doctor and found that they had a terminal illness. And you see, that lack of appetite physically was an indication that something was wrong. And when we have a lack of appetite spiritually, when we're not hungering and thirsting for the things of God, it is an indication to us that something is not right in our relationship with the Lord, that something is spiritually wrong, because righteousness for the believer is to be a way of life. Now, I want to show you something else here. We see the pathway to righteousness. And this is for believers. We know that righteousness comes through Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And when Christ comes into our life, then how are we to live? What are some things that we can engage in our Christian life that will enable us to continue on this pathway to righteousness in our journey on earth? Well, let me share five things with you very quickly. And we're going to move through these very, very quickly. First, remember how much God loves you. Remember how much God loves you. We need to do that every day of our lives. In fact, I want to encourage you from now on, every morning when you get up in the morning, before you say anything else, say, Lord, help me to remember today how much you love me. That'll just start your day off right. Just remember how much God loves you. The more we understand how much he loves us, the more we're going to love him. And you see, when we don't feel that close to God, we begin to think, well, maybe I do not really love God as much as I should. But most of the time, that's not really our problem. Our problem is not that we don't love God enough. Our problem is that we just don't understand how much God loves us. And he really does love us. He's head over heels in love with you this morning. And the Bible says we love him because he first loved us. Secondly, we can cultivate a spiritual appetite. Cultivate a spiritual appetite. Most of the time, our tendency is to fill up on spiritual junk food. If we're not hungry for God's righteousness, it's because we're full of self, or either we're full of the world's crumbs. And we need to be filling up on things that are spiritual. Don't fill up on the crumbs of the world. Fill up on the living bread. What are you putting in your mind every day? What are you watching on television? Cultivate a spiritual appetite, and then make knowing God a priority. Make knowing God a priority in your life. If we make knowing Him a priority, we will always maintain a spiritual hunger. In the book of Psalms, David is constantly expressing his desire to know God, and he would say things like, God, I thirst for you. I hunger for you, God. I earnestly seek you, God. You see, he made knowing God the priority of his life. And that's what Jesus is talking about. In Matthew 6:33, Jesus said, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Four, stay in God's word. If you want to maintain this pathway to righteousness, stay in God's word. This is food for our soul. The Bible calls itself bread and milk and meat. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And I hope all of us are reading our Bibles every day. If we ate one day, and then we didn't eat for 3 days, and then we ate again, before long we would get sick, because we need to eat every day to stay good and healthy. It's the same spiritually. If we read our Bibles one day and then we don't read for 4 or 5 days and we read another day, we're going to become spiritually anemic and sick. So we need to read every day. You say, well, what do I do if I miss a day? Well, don't stop. A lot of people, they miss a day and then they'll stop because the devil will whisper to us and say, well, you've already blown it now. No use to keep going. But what we need to do, if you fall off the horse, get back in the saddle. Amen? I mean, just pick it up and start reading the next day. And this is our food. So stay in God's word. And then spend time with people who love God. I mean, we ought to just love to be around people who love God. Let me show you what I mean. When my grandkids all come to my house and one of them says, I'm hungry, you know what the other four are going to say? I'm hungry too. And so I'll go get them a red popsicle out of the refrigerator. Now you're going to want one of those. And every time I get them a red popsicle and they're all eating popsicles, before long I'm eating a popsicle. And you see, we need to, it's like that. It's contagious when we get around people that love God. It's like that. It makes us love God more to be around other people that really love God. We want what they want. Proverbs 2:20 says, join the company of good men and women who will keep you on the path of the righteous. So spend time with people who love God. And that's the reason you hear me talk about being in Sunday school quite a bit. It's because we need to be with other people who love God. We need to surround ourselves with people who love God. And if you're not in a class, I hope you'll consider visiting a class and being part of it. It's a blessing, and you'll be a blessing to others as you do that too. Well, let's look at one more thing and we're finished. I want you to see before we leave this morning the blessing of the righteous person. The blessing of the righteous person. Look back at verse 6 at what Jesus said. He said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Read it with me. For they shall be filled. That's the blessing of the righteous person. They shall be filled. Now I want you to look at the words hunger and thirst. Those are words of great passion. Few of us have really been hungry to the point of starving. Few of us have really been thirsty to the point of just starving and thirsting for water. But in Palestine, where Jesus lived and the surrounding area, it was different from today. And every day, a worker would go out into the field to work. And at the end of the day, the worker would be paid on a day-by-day basis. They didn't get a paycheck every week or every 2 weeks or every month the way we're accustomed to. But they would be paid every day. They work one day, they're paid that day. And on the way home, they would take what they were paid, and they would stop, and they would buy bread, and they would buy food for their family. And they would come home, and the family would eat whatever they bought with whatever they had earned that day. So if a person was sick, or if a person could not find work for the day, or if they were lazy and did not work that day, then their family had nothing to eat at night, nothing to eat at all. And so it was not uncommon in Bible days for people to get extremely hungry. And some of them would have to miss a meal for several days, and they would be famished. And then in Palestine, in that day where Jesus lived, sometimes there would be wells or springs, and most people walked wherever they went, and there were times when those wells or springs would dry up. And when it was terribly hot, they would fill an animal skin with water and take it with them because their lips would be parched and they would be thirsty. Have you ever really been thirsty and you drank too much? Just thirsty. Or really been hungry? A lot of people around this world are hungry. There are people in America today who are hungry. I've held starving people, starving children in my hands, and it breaks your heart when you see people who are starving, really starving. And the truth is, we feed our dogs in America better than a lot of countries feed their children. The starving people. And so God is teaching us here to be hungry is not enough. We must be starving to know what is in God's heart toward us. We must be starving. We want to feed on the things of God, not like the prodigal who fed on the husk of the swine. He got tired of that, though, and what did he do? He went back to the Father. To those who hunger, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. To those who are thirsty, Jesus says, I am the living water. The Psalm says in 107:9, for he satisfies the longing soul and he fills the hungry with his goodness. And everybody said, amen. When we hunger and thirst after righteousness, Jesus says we will be filled. I want you to circle that word filled in verse 6. It was used in the day of Jesus to refer to the feeding of animals, and it meant that they would feed until they wanted nothing more. To be full, they were allowed to eat until they were completely satisfied. And this is teaching us that when we hunger and thirst for righteousness, that Jesus will give us total satisfaction. And if we have no spiritual appetite, one of two reasons for that. First, we may be feeding on the husk of the swine. We have allowed things of the world to come in, and we're no longer feasting on the Word of God. Second, it could be that we're spiritually dead. One thing I have never seen in my life, and I've seen a lot of dead people, but I've never seen a dead person eat. I've never seen that. Have you? A corpse does not eat. A person that is spiritually dead has no interest in eating the things of God. And being part of the things of God. We have no appetite for that. And that indicates a spiritual problem. Years ago, a pastor came to a country church down in Texas in an area of the state that has hundreds and hundreds of miles that are just flat, called the Flatlands. He got there for the evening service, and he preached, and everybody greeted him after church, and he was going to spend the night with a deacon. And so after the service, it was in the horse and buggy days, he went out and got in his buggy. And it was dark, and what he didn't know, that while he was preaching, some boys in the church decided they'd play a joke on the new preacher, and they took the small wheels off the front of the buggy and put them in the back, and took the big wheels off the back and put them in the front. And so you can imagine this, the big wheels in the front, the small wheels in the back, and the preacher got in the buggy that night, and he didn't notice it. He rode all the way, just like that, with his horse, all the way to the deacon's house. So he went to the deacon's house, and he put his buggy in the barn, and he went to his room, and he went to bed. The next morning, he got up, and he went out to the road, and the deacon looked out the window, and the deacon saw the preacher looking up the road. So he went out, and he said, "Parson, what are you doing out here?" Preacher said, "I'm looking for that steep hill that I climbed from the church to your house last night." The deacon said, "Preacher, there's not a hill within 100 miles of here. Look at that road. It's as flat as it can be." The preacher said, "Now, I know there is a hill all the way from your church to your house because I rode on the back of my neck to get here, and it almost killed my horse climbing that hill." Well, in a few minutes, they walked over to the barn where the preacher had put his buggy, and they saw what had happened. Those wheels had been reversed, and they both started to laugh. The deacon went over there and slapped the preacher on the back of his neck, and he said, "Parson, there's a mighty sermon in this." He said, "In life, when you get things in front that belong behind, and you get things behind that belong in front, you're going to live your life on the back of your neck." And that's true. And I wonder this morning, dear friend, if your life could be like that. I wonder if the Holy Spirit of God is speaking to you this morning about how your life ought to be. Are you sincerely hungering and thirsting after righteousness? And if not, why not? I want to close with a simple question. Do you hunger for God and the things of God? Would you come this morning hungering and thirsting for God with all the sincerity of your soul, convicted by the Spirit of God? For the Bible says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." Let us hunger and thirst after righteousness that we may be filled. And Jesus said, that is the way to happiness. All of God's people said. Let's stand together. And as we sing this morning, we invite anyone here who would like to know the Lord Jesus as your Savior to come forward. Anyone here who would like to unite with our church to come forward. And anyone here who would like to pray, you just come forward and pray. Here and in the Christian Life Center, you come as we sing, "You Come."